Dobrý den, já vás tady vítám. Jsem rád, že jste dorazili v takovým velkým počtu. Koho by nelákala umělá inteligence? Jsem rád, že tady vidím spoustu známých tváří, který tady umělou inteligenci a data mining studují na FITu. A doufám, že se tady dneska dozvíme spoustu zajímavých věcí od velmi zajímavé firmy. Asi jste si všichni podívali na jejich profil, to znamená, víte, že mají za sebou spoustu zajímavých projektů, které teda nejsou úplně zaměřený do umělé inteligence, ale to nevadí, protože Marek předtím vůbec nedělal programátora, že jo? Pak se rozhodl, že bude programátor a rychle se to naučil a exceloval v tom a potom teď se rozhodl, že teda bude dělat tu umělou inteligenci, takže pokud se to povede stejně, jako se povedly třeba ty hry, jako Space Engineers a takhle, tak se máme na co těšit. Myslím si, že teď zrovna nazrál ten čas, kdy se to trošičku láme už a ten výzkum kolem umělé inteligence začíná nabírat na obrátkách a už si toho všimli i třeba takový ty lidi, kteří mají peníze a začali investovat třeba do firem, které jsou právě založený na nějakých věcech kolem umělé inteligence. Když si dáte chvíli práci a podíváte se na to, kolik vlastně venture kapitálu dostali firmy na umělou inteligenci, tak to letos bylo asi 380 milionů dolarů, ale důležité je, že tam je taková pěkná exponenciála z minulých let. Takže víte, že jsou takový DeepMind firmy, které koupily Googleové a tak dále, to asi všichni víte nebo tušíte. My tady na FITu taky umělou inteligenci děláme, máme tady laboratoř datových věd, tam se snažíme vám udělat zázemí, abyste mohli dělat zajímavé věci, třeba hrát Angry Birds nebo tak, mocí umělé inteligence. A jsem rád, že ta umělá inteligence se začíná dostávat i do jiných oblastí. A tato obecná umělá inteligence, o kterých tady bude dneska řeč, tak ta je teprve zajímavá. Takže já už koukám, že kamera je nainstalována, takže bych předal z toho Markovi. A vítám vás tady.
A děkujem vlastně všetkým za to, že přišli na tuto našu přednášku. Zároveň vlastně za chvilku se prepnem do angličtiny. Z toho dôvodu, že sme sa rozhodli spraviť túto prednášku v angličtine, aby keďže sa nahráva, tak my chceme potom neskôr zverejniť na internete, aby vlastne aj ďalší ľudia uvideli, takže preto bude celá v angličtine. Welcome for coming to this presentation. It will be an introduction to General Artificial Intelligence Research at King Software House. And first, a little introduction. I will talk about who we are or what we have done before. Then I will speak a little about the short project history, I mean this AI project history. Then I will speak about how our research team works. Then I will speak about what is actually general artificial intelligence and why we think it's so important. And then I will go to our long-term plans, short-term plans, where there will be two parts. One will be short-term plans focused on research and development, and the other part will be short-term plans focused on commercialization or some commercial application of what we do. And at the end, I will discuss some open problems, and then the presentation will switch to Dušan and Martin, who will continue in more technical stuff. So my first part will be, or should be really easy to understand for normal people. That's basically the goal of the presentation. So about us, or about me in this case, I had interest in AI and robotics since I was 15 years old, and back then I actually didn't know how to start this project or what to do, and but I kind of felt that I need to start my own company and basically do the research under my own company and not just some academia or things like that. And it's probably mostly because I'm the type of person who wants to have things under control and who also wants to start things. So later, many years later, actually, I would like to point out one thing that Pavel, actually I started as a programmer. When I was 15, I started programming, and basically I was until 30-something. And during that path, actually I started Kin Software House, and then after some time I stopped being a programmer, and I'm just you know, like the boss or something like that. So, but I started as a programmer, you know, and so how to achieve this, or how to get a chance to achieve general artificial intelligence research? I was thinking that, okay, my second interest was virtual reality and games, and so I decided that it's a thing I like, so let's make some game, make money, and then invest the money to AI research. And so after many tries and, you know, like things like that, we actually got first successful game, which was Space Engineers, and it started to sell very well, so we were able to invest the money in this AI project, and just couple of months ago we also started the second engineering game, Medieval Engineers, which also sells very well, so we are able to also invest this money, or what we can invest in AI research. Not everything, but, you know, some important part. So that was my plan, basically make money on games, invest it in AI, and the next step was to set up an AI research team with people who will share the same goal as I have with AI, and that's basically what we are doing last year. And because we are lucky with the games, the development funds for AI project we have right now is over $10 million, so we really can focus on long-term plans, and we are not pushed by short-term goals like release some application in a year or 2 years. We really can do things for 10 years, and we are allowed to do this. So the project started in January 2014, that's more than a year ago. At the beginning, it was just Martin, first member, and then some other people started to join, as we realized that we can actually, that we have funds to hire more people, that we are not limited. And at the beginning, we were considering various approaches to AI, from really biologically based, like spiking neural networks, and another, to approaches that are really artificial, more like mathematical. And at the current stage of the project, we are more inclining to the artificial methods, but we are still inspired by biology and mostly like behavioral psychology and things like that. Along the path, or during last year, we made a tool, it's called Brain Simulator, and it's an application or an environment where we test our hypotheses and where we develop our models, or we call it brains. And Dušan, he will speak in detail about this. One of the biggest milestones we achieved in this year was an AI brain that's able to play a Pong game. It's a similar thing as Google DeepMind achieved. And again, Dušan will explain more details. And we don't consider this to be some huge breakthrough. It was just one of the milestones we wanted to achieve. And now we are focusing on next milestone and next milestone. And during last year, the team grown to 12 people, I think. And it's still growing. Actually, there was a moment where we said, like, okay, let's stop at 10 people and let's see. But after a few months or few weeks, we decided to just continue hiring more people because we have the funds and the project and the possible potential of this project seems so important that there is no reason to save money or not to do it. Now I will speak about how our team works, how we do the development or how we do the research. We have two periods. We go from very specific milestones to periods or two times where there is a free research where people can do almost whatever they want or what they decide. And so we are switching these two phases. There is this free phase and there is milestone phase. And each one is usually 1 or 2 months long. And the milestone is good because milestone usually sets some goal that we can test, that we can say like, okay, we achieved the goal, the milestone, because these and these goals are accomplished. And whereas then there is this free research thing where people can go more freely and basically do what they want. And then later in the milestone phase, we actually converge back to some very specific point. We have two meetings, like team meetings each week. It's usually, it's every Tuesday and Thursday. And one is brainstorming, where everybody can speak up and just say anything he wants. For example, something he read somewhere, or some new discovery he made, or just ask other people. And then there is the other meeting, we call it update meeting, and on these meetings everyone stands up and says what he achieved since the last meeting, and what is he going to do. And this is good because it allows us to share the knowledge, and also it allows other people to know what other people are working on. So this is how we do meetings. We also try to replicate like project management ideas or methodologies we use in the game team, because it works there. And this fast development, rapid iteration, all these things really work well for games. So there is a good chance they should work for AI research as well. Except there is one difference, of course, that AI research is more like the goals are not so, sometimes not so easily attainable, and also the results are not so cool as, you know, in the games. But we anyway, we try to replicate the way we do the game development. And for this, we give ourselves a goal, then try to get to that goal as fast as possible to see if it was a good idea or a bad idea. And then we have a fast feedback, we know if it was a good idea or a bad idea, and in case it was a good idea, we continue. If it was a bad idea, we kill it and just start some other thing. So like in industry, this is called like rapid iteration, and it allows basically quickly finding good ways and like leaving the bad ways. And what's next? I will speak about this more later, but what we want to do is move our project from stealth mode, where it was until now, where we didn't speak much about the project, to a more open project where we will be explaining what we found out, what's our progress, what we are going to do, and we also are going to allow third-party developers to kind of join our team and help with the development. And the reason for it is that it's also an inspiration from the game development, where we found that if we get fast feedback from customers and players, it creates kind of pressure on the team to actually deliver fast results and not spend time on some academic ideas or things like that. And also we hope that we will get ideas from the community of other developers and researchers, or even people who are not expert on AI, but maybe they will have some interesting insight. And so now the interesting part, why are we developing artificial intelligence? This part may seem crazy for some of you, and but it's probably the most interesting part to understand why we are developing general AI. So I will start first with explaining the difference between narrow and general AI. Narrow AI is like artificial intelligence algorithm that's focusing on just some specific problem and cannot be applied to a different problem, or maybe after some heavy changes. On the contrary, general AI is AI that can adapt to any type of problem and then move on another problem, just like people. So that's why we want to develop general AI, and we are not really focusing on specific narrow AI algorithms. Or if we are, then only as a part of the architecture. AI is the, from the investment point of view, and I'm not speaking only about money, but also about from the point of view of our effort, our time, it has the highest return on investment possible. if we imagine some money spent on AI today, and if you consider that the AI in future will self-evolve or self-develop, self-replicate, the growth will be exponential, and it will just be, in my opinion, brutal. So, I mean, the growth will be brutal, not the AI will be brutal. And so when we consider this, the market for AI, or the things where people can benefit from general AI, can be practically unlimited, because we don't think it will just end on Earth. I think, we think it will continue to the universe. So market size from like investor point of view is unlimited. It also could be our final invention, and I don't mean this in a wrong way, like we'll make AI and then we are done. I mean it in a way that we create AI, and from that moment AI will keep going and inventing its own thing in a direction that we consider to be useful for us. That's the idea, that let AI invent all the millions of other things that there are to be invented. How we see it is that, and in future there can be AI scientists, programmers, engineers, basically AI anything. And we are assuming that the AI will do the job better than people. And that everybody will benefit from AI future, and that the AI will change the world in 10 to 50 years. So we'll see. So our long-term goals is to develop a human-level artificial intelligence, and by this I mean AI that has the same mental or cognitive capabilities as people. So it should be able to learn and adapt to an environment while seeking what's most beneficial for the AI, or maximizing its reward function. And the principle of our project is basically that we are trying to build a brain where on one side there is input from sensors, it can be vision, auditory sensors, whatever. Then there is input signal which is reward and punishment, so the AI actually knows if this doing good, if it is doing a good thing or bad thing. And on the output there is some muscle, for example muscle commands, or some motor commands, or anything like this. And what's in the middle, that's the brain. And we are trying to build a universal brain that's capable of finding patterns in input signals, also output signals, and in the signals that are happening in the middle or inside the brain, and is able to find associations, correlations, causalities in these signals, and then act in a way that's maximizing the reward. This is the principle of what we are trying to do. So in our opinion, it doesn't matter if the AI will be used on a robot, like a hardware robot, or a car, or a virtual simulation robot, or a game, or even some database application, because the brain will be able to learn the patterns, all the patterns that are coming in, coming out, coming inside, and then do what's best for the reward function. And about the reward, this is the interesting thing, that we as creators can say what's the reward. If we say if it was people, then the reward would be survival. In the case of robot, we don't need a robot to survive, so we can say what is a reward. So it can be, if it is a cleaning robot, his reward can be like good, you know, good cleaning, or maybe his owner saying like, okay, you did a good job. That can be his reward, and he doesn't need to have a much more or like higher reward. So we don't need to be worried about AI taking over the world or something like this, if the reward system will be correctly set. And one thing that we also keep in mind is learning. We don't want to make AI that's pre-programmed in some way. And this means that AI should be able to learn online while the signals are coming in, coming out. There is not like a phase for training or offline learning or something like this. It's like with people. People are receiving signals, they are processing it, it's coming out, and then again and again and again. It's like a one loop that's just going forever. So also our AI should be able to process all this data online. And the way AI will learn what to do is basically by interacting with the environment, just like people do when a human is born. It has, except some inborn architecture, it has no knowledge about the world, doesn't know what to do, and basically the baby will start learning one thing after another thing by interacting with the environment, with itself, with other people, and it will create a hierarchy of patterns of what's good or what to do in each situation, and so on. Our short-term goals, as I mentioned, one short-term goal which we achieved was AI that's able to play Pong. We made it in a similar way as DeepMind. This means that the AI sees just the raw pixels on screen on a Pong emulator. The AI brain doesn't have structured information about the world of the Pong. It just has this unstructured raw pixels. And AI needs to, the image signal needs to go through some series of pre-processing, and basically the AI needs to find some patterns in what it sees. Then it needs to find patterns in when it's getting reward and punishment. In our case, it's when the ball drops, that's punishment, and when the ball kicks up, that's a reward. And the goal of AI is to understand the patterns where it's getting reward and then try to replicate those situations or what it did in those situations, and at the same time avoid situation where it's getting punishment. That's the principle. And also in our case, it wasn't born with any pre-programmed information. It just has to learn this from unstructured data. Upcoming milestones that we are going to approach in a month and something is AI that's able to play much more complex game than Pong, because in fact Pong is actually quite a simple environment, and you don't need intelligence to play Pong. So that's not good testing environment for us, and we create a little game which has little more complex environment and little more complex game rules, and this our AI will need to again find situation or act in situation in a way that it gets reward and avoid situation where it's getting punishment. And this new game will be a little bit more complex because it will have something we call delayed reward, and this means that it needs to do something, then something, then something, and then it gets reward. And the AI needs to understand the entire pattern, the entire sequence, and to know that it got the reward because first it did this, then this, then this, and so on, and then it can generalize this information or this pattern and try it again in a different situation, maybe a little bit different way. And then the next much more advanced milestone will be AI that's able to play multiple games, not at the same time, but the idea is that we will let the AI play one game, it will learn to play the game, then we will let it play another game, it will learn the game, then we will connect it again to the first game, and it will be able to play that game without forgetting the information or forgetting the knowledge how to play the game. And along all these things, we are working on something which I can describe like muscle control, which is part of our modular architecture, where instead of controlling a pedal in Pong by just moving left, right, we are trying to control a body where you have multiple muscles and you need to control them in a sequence. It's like playing on a piano or something like this, and you need to basically send the signals in the correct sequence so it will actually execute useful behavior. For example, like balancing, it's never just one command, but it's a multitude of commands, and they need to be kind of played in a sequence. And now about the commercial short-term goals. I said that we have this like long-term vision, 10 years or even more, but we also want to do something that will be useful for other people while we are developing our long-term goal. And for this, we decided that during this year, I think it will be in the middle of the year, we will open the Brain Simulator, this environment we are using, to other people, probably like for free. We'll also open a marketplace where other developers will be able to develop their own AI modules, upload it to this marketplace. Of course, other people will be able to download. People will be able to upload projects, these brains, and other people will be able to download them. And so basically, we are trying to create a platform or ecosystem where not just us, but other people will be exchanging their ideas and modules for AI. And hopefully, it will grow, and it will also help us to get further in the project. And basically, this is the part where we are seeking the pressure from the external world, because we believe that if our project is visible to other people, we'll actually work much harder, and we'll be more focused on some useful results of the research, and not just playing with some ideas. And there can be the commercial idea, like results. What we think is that at the beginning there won't be many, because the AI has this disadvantage that it's actually it needs to be useful for some people to use it. If you have an AI that's just able to play Pong, you are not going to hire it to drive your car, you know, or do some job. You actually need to cross certain threshold, and until then, the AI is not useful. So also in this case, we think that at the beginning it will go very slow, and there will be basically it will be just a place for hobbyists to exchange these modules and push us. But not many companies will actually use the ecosystem, and this will change in the moment when there will be actually useful modules that can do something that's useful for people. And our business model for this could be licensing these brains to companies that are building either robots or either software application that can use some AI in them. And that's the idea, basically. We are also considering equity crowdfunding. Not that we need it that much, but the reason is, there are basically two reasons. First is that allow people to invest in AI, and I will explain later why we think it's good for people, beneficial. And also, equity crowdfunding can serve as like public relation kind of thing for the project, because people who like the idea of AI and who understand its long-term benefits, if they invest in AI, they will be actually some kind of like messengers, or they will be spreading the idea of the company. And just quick explanation, what is equity crowdfunding? It's basically a way where people can buy little shares, little pieces of the company by investing in the company. That's the idea. And together with these commercial short-term goals, we will continue in a basic research and development that we are working on right now. Any problems on the R&D part, so this will continue. But if there will be some early commercial application on our platform, we'll actually try to integrate it in our R&D project and the way it's going. And now to open problems. Recently, there has been a lot of talk about dangers of AI and stuff like that, and we are also like reading these articles, books, and thinking about it. And our take on this is that, of course, it can be dangerous, but there are multiple reasons why we think that if the AI will have safe reward system, and if the reward will not be kill all people, but actually be useful to people, for example, and also if the AI will be advanced enough to understand that collaboration is better than competition, then it will not present a danger to us. That's basically our idea about AI safety. And there is actually or there are more important things than killer robots, and that's the impact of AI and robots on job market in the next 10 or 20 years. And as you probably noticed, there are many jobs that are being replaced by automation, not just robots, but software or anything that can be automated. And people in these jobs, they are losing those jobs, and they don't have a value from job market that they can offer, so basically they stay unemployed. And we think this can be a bigger danger for people. If we imagine that 50% of people or 80% of people don't have a job because nobody needs them to do any job, because can hire a robot or some AI software, then that's a bigger problem for those people. So our approach to this, or solution to this, is actually start investing either people or governments, or you know who wants, start investing in AI companies now when it's actually quite cheap, and basically in future have some kind of pension or dividends from AI companies. That's what we are actually doing here, except that we are doing the R&D end. And then there is this problem with narrow AI, as I described, and the thing is that we will, this applies also to our project, and we understand that we will need to wait until the threshold is met to have AI that's actually useful. It's like, for example, you probably know about Google self-driving cars, and it sounds cool, but if it's not working 100% and if there are still some situation where it won't work, then people will not use the technology. So I hope it will work, because I want such car, but it really needs to work. And this applies to everything in AI, that you need to meet the threshold to get further. And one open problem that we were considering at the beginning of the project, right now it's not a big issue for us, but it was the idea that if we will be actually able, if we ever will be able to simulate intelligence that's on the level of human brain, because if you just do the pure calculation, like 100 billion neurons, if you try to simulate it on a computer, it will require extreme amount of memory and everything like this. So our kind of idea about this is that we hope that our algorithms will be a little bit more optimized than how nature did its job. And this is one solution, and the other is that Moore's law is working in our benefit. And since we started the project now, quite soon, in 10 years or 15 years, the computers will be much faster and advanced, so maybe we'll just meet them in the right time. And so what can you do for yourself if you want to benefit from AI? You can invest in AI companies, and or you can consider, if you are an AI researcher, programmer, or PR guy, you can join our team. We are still looking for AI researchers and programmers, basically the guys that we have right now in the team who are doing the basic R&D. Couple of weeks ago, we decided to actually start hiring some software architects and engineers who will work on, not on the research, but who will work on the infrastructure for Brain Simulator and for this platform marketplace I mentioned. So that position is open, and also we are looking for a PR guy who will help us like spread the word about what we are doing, and it's an ongoing plan. And since we don't have a dedicated website or a company for this AI project, it's right now it's under Keen Software House, but during this year we will spin it off to a separate company. And I don't want to reveal the name of the company yet, so we don't have a website where you can follow what we are doing. So right now just please follow my blog and Keen Software House website, and when there will be right time, we will announce this new company, and then you can start following that. So thank you, and now Dušan will continue.
OK, Okay, so again, good evening. My name is Dušan Fedorčák, and I will like to give you a little more technical insight into our project. So, as Marek said, we are developing an artificial general intelligence, and we understand it, right now, it may change in the future, but we understand it as an autonomous agent which is able to perceive and change its environment, able to remember, reason, plan, and it's adaptable, can learn from its environment, can remember such a knowledge, and finally, it is able to communicate. So this is our goal, and we have to decide what we are going to use for fulfilling such a goal. And there are many ways how these things can be done, and most of these are quite sophisticated, like classical AI architectures, some inference machine expert system, you probably heard some of them. And actually there are some cognitive architecture definitions already. Of course, there are artificial neural networks quite famous for some very interesting tasks they can do, and maybe even multi-agent systems with their social abilities and stuff. And we'll probably need all of them. So there's another problem. How are we going to use them together? How we connect them and incorporate it into a bigger system? And we need a tool for that. And of course, we also want to implement our own modules to the system, and we want to connect them and make them cooperate. So we need something we can develop in, and we need also something where we can see the whole model. And we are at this point believe that the rich interface, the graphical view of the system, and the visualization abilities of such a tool will be quite crucial. And also we want to control the simulation with appropriate tools and run it on different architectures with using of various hardware, and the other things like parallel execution should be possible with such a tool. And we were thinking what we are going to use for that, and well, unfortunately, there are some flaws with all existing systems we find, and we decided to build something which will be able to connect already existing frameworks and libraries into one, and we inspired from things like Maya Material Editor, if you know, or with the Simulink, or even this robot operational system software. And also we want to incorporate existing libraries like CAFE for DeepNets and others. So our solution is the brain simulator application, as Marek already said. And the main idea is that you have modules which can be connected through data connections, which is not really a new idea, but we think it's a good idea. And inside these modules, we call them nodes, there are tasks. These tasks can handle parts of memory blocks, and these memory blocks holds the data of the model. And the overall brain is connected to the environment, to the world, where the world can pass data into the model, into the brain, and then some controls can be applied to a body which actually lives in the world. And also there is a view for such a model, and there are observers for model data, so there is a set of standard methods how data can be viewed. And during the execution, the researcher can change model parameters through graphical UI, Also, there's some adjustable observers. Even you can write your own observers. You can, of course, write your own nodes. And you can control the whole simulation with that. Right now, the brain simulator uses CUDA technology as a parallel implementation. We are implementing also Intel Phi support, and it is possible to run your models on multiple GPUs if you have like multiple GPUs installed in your machine. This is a screenshot of the main window of the brain simulator, and you can see that there are some nodes connected, some standard observer open probably on the visual input to the brain, and there are some other dialogues around where you can change, for example, parameters during runtime and some other things. Okay, so during development of this system and during research on this project, we already implemented a set of different modules, and there are some of them, as you can see, there are standard feed-forward nets and some recurrent nets, also some self-organization models like the famous Kohonen map or growing neural gas, which is very useful, for example, for long-term memories. And also, we are interested in vectoric symbolic architecture. I will say something more about that later. And we imported some existing modules like CAFE, which is the framework for deep learning and stuff like this. There's just a short example how easy is to use brain simulator. This node here is the Kohonen map, and it's run on MNIST dataset, which you might know. It's the quite a big database of handwritten digits, and usually researchers are competing each other to get a better classificator about that set. So you can build such kind of experiment like in 5 minutes. And later, maybe we can play a little with the brain simulator. Okay, so that was about the tool. So right now, we have a goal we want to achieve. We have a tool. And I would like to talk a little more about how we're going to achieve this goal with this tool. So Marek already mentioned that we are betting on iterative approach, quite similar to extreme programming from our side. And it relies on early implementation and experimenting with models. So whenever you can, you build an experiment, maybe you read a paper, get an idea, but still you should be able to make an experiment as soon as possible. Then we separate maybe the ideas into team members and try to do some separate experiments like proof of concepts with different stuff like data representation, memory models, learning strategy, things like that. And when the milestone comes, as Marek already said, all these models will be merged together into something functional. So we are usually using these separate experiments with some like mocked-up parts where you can extract some information from the world itself. Like we can ignore computer vision, for example, and just take some data from the world and test some symbolic architecture or whatever. Yeah, and the whole model then is incorporated into milestone, and I would like to give you some details about one or two milestones we already achieved. So the first milestone as a test of integration of these parts and test of methodology was the six-leg robot milestone, which is actually connected to the Space Engineers game. And there's a runtime visual data processing. And after that, the data is somehow handled inside very easily and turned into the body control, which is then sent back to the Space Engineers game where the robot is implemented and it controls the body. The whole system is totally supervised, and there are some like hard-wired movements. The robot learns from the mentor how to move its body, and there is a very simple vision to action association. So actually, the robot will learn from what he see how to act. So the just okay, I'm seeing something, and the mentor is moving my body to the left side, so I'll remember that. So that was the first experiment. Just give you a little view. So as you can see, there is a view to the Space Engineers game. And on the upper part here, there are controls to the different joints of the robot. And well, basically that's it. So on this one, we tested that we are able to incorporate all the parts together, and we moved on. The next milestone was the Pong, or the breakout game. And this one gets really interesting because it's really from the bitmap to buttons. There's no other information for the brain than the bitmap and the reward or punishment signals. And this is turned over time into actions. And there are some parts of it, there are some interesting parts of the brain. And I will talk a little more about the insights. Okay, so this is the global model which plays Pong, and you can see that there's a visual input and the image processing module, visual working memory module. And here, bitmap is passed. Bitmap is turned into segments or the super pixels or the candidates for objects you want to track. And inside the visual memory, this information is turned into symbols. And symbols can be viewed as a distributed representation of the data you, the robot actually is seeing, or the agent is seeing. And these symbols are then passed into higher reasoning part of the brain, where the goal memory is formed, which is conditioned with the reward or punishment signal. And the action learning module, where appropriate actions are learned according to the fitness, which is passed from the goal memory. Well, this is a little insight into the image processing part. Is not something really new, I think. It's for demonstrative purposes, it's on a different game. But you can see that there's an input image which is segmented into these super pixels. And these super pixels are weighed somehow. So if like these two super pixels are the part of the same object or not, and then this graph is reduced into the object representation, and you can see that there are objects identified, and these objects can be then tracked and used by the brain. Okay, so now a little more about the goal memory. So you can see that this part is here, and the goal memory itself contains two parts. And according to the reward signal or punishment signal, the agent will remember the state of the working memory he wants to achieve. Or, on the other hand, it will remember the goal state. It's not the goal state, it's some state it wants to avoid. And from such information, a fitness value is created, and the fitness value is passed into the action learning mechanism, which effectively learns action from the past. So the bot will, or the agent will, perform an action, and from this action, the fitness value is created if actually the bot is closer to the goal or it is farther from the goal. And if it is closer, the fitness value becomes positive, this net becomes active, and a training pattern is created for the net. So it is something like, okay, this moved me closer to my goal state. I want to learn that. I want to learn that action in this particular state. So in the future, I'll repeat that more probably. And now we can watch the result. Pause it a little. Well, here you can see the output of the vision system, and there's always some part for cues, and it is a basic model of attention, where the attention of the brain iterates through tracked objects in order to capture what's interesting in a scene. So there are some strategies how the brain will find out that something is interesting, and one of the part of the strategy is, for example, movement. So things that moves are usually interesting. And here you can see the output of the action learning system. This one is the action which is actually taken. This is the left, stay where are you, where you are, and this is go to the right. And this is a kind of similarity measure between the positive goal and the negative goal state and the actual content of the working memory. And the green one, which is not really able to see here, but okay, the green one is the similarity between the current state and the positive goal state, and the red one is the similarity between the negative goal state. And it means that if the brain is learned correctly, then the green line should be above the red line. The similarity between the goal, the positive goal state, should be bigger. Okay, so. Well, it's not a surprise, it plays ball. And you can see how the attention model constantly changing the attention between the ball, the pedal, and the rest of the scene. Of course, it's not perfect. The quality of learning is around 90%. Okay, so what will be next? The next milestone we already decided is a two-dimensional egocentric game where the agent will be placed in the two-dimensional world. He will perceive the nearest proximity of itself, and there will be a navigation and inner spatial representation of the environment which is necessary to take some interesting action. And we want to implement an variable extraction, and above that, or this variable extraction should be probably done by something like hierarchical Q-learning algorithm, where multiple goals and motivation can be formed, and a kind of gold chaining should be possible. And when I'm talking about gold chaining, I mean something, okay, if I want to get a reward, I need to open the door, then open another door, don't fall into the pit, and then I will get my reward. So something which is not really possible with a system like this, because in this system you can always, or you must be able always to measure how close you're in to the goal state. And of course, if there is a door in a way, then it is not possible to really measure every taken action, because if you open the door, the similarity to the goal state will change enormously. And so that would be the next milestone, and some future milestone, as Marek already said, should be playing the same, with the same model, playing different games. So we will learn one game, and then we'll test that we are able to learn different game with the same model. The next milestone should be playing the different games with same model instance. So one model trained on one game will be then retrained into another game, but with the condition that it must not forget playing the first one. So there must be a kind of a context detection mechanism inside such a model. And also, as a, let's say, side project, there's a project of motoric systems, which is right now not very connected to these milestones, as you can see, but we will need them, and I think very soon we'll need to be able to control some complex body like bipedal robot or something like this. So we should be able to learn the system to manipulate with its complex body to perform some sequences of movements in order to use manipulators or even balance and stuff like that. And also during the way, or we should be able to extend, and we need to go further with our platform, with our framework, and we want to release the brain simulator to the community. So I hope you'll be able to use our tool even for your experiments, and I'll be very happy to see such a situation. And also we want HPC solution be implemented inside our tool, so even very big models can be simulated inside the tool and controlled and effectively experimenting with. And also in the next phase, we'll be targeting Unix system releases, because we are aware that not all of you are happy to use C# and Microsoft Windows. So, thank you very much for your attention, and now the question session will begin.
Good evening, I'm Martin Balek, and the last third of our session will be not standard talk, but it's open for your questions, where you can ask whatever you want, either technical or more philosophical questions. It's open for you, because we are really interested in your feedback, what you think about our project, and what you have some suggestions. Because we are here quite in a big amount, we need to somehow use microphones, so when you are, if you are in somewhere, if you are in, just ask for a microphone and we will handle it for you. So it is now open for your questions. And we will try to answer. If I don't know the answer, some of my colleagues will answer.
And you can also ask in Czech. We really don't care if you want.
Hello, thank you for the introduction of your company and project. In the video of the game Pong, I saw there was some sort of attention marker on the objects in the game. And I wonder, why did you decide to use just a limited attention for the system that follows after it? Does this make sense to you, the question?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So the question was why there is any attention model at all. Yeah, so we believe that the attention model is quite crucial for the system because, for example, the Google Mind implementation takes the whole picture and then tries to do some approximations on that. But this is going a little opposite to the way how, for example, human brains operates, because it is known from several studies that an attention model is inside the brain. And this attention model is implemented in your visual brain. So it's not just a matter of your eyes moving the retina in the position when the retina has at most cells it is possible, but also the attention, for example, for the size of the objects you're perceiving can be changed inside your brain. And we tries to implement that, and we find that there are some positive attributes for that. For example, you can find different shapes inside different shapes, or inside various shapes. And when you're like identifying an object, for example, a bicycle, then you can tell that the bicycle is the part of two circular things, and then something edgy inside. Yeah, and in this way you can build a hierarchical representation of the symbol you're perceiving, which is more flexible than just focusing on the whole picture.
Thank you. I would like to ask you, do you think your AI will be able to grasp the concept of games like chess or Go, as these are like the holy grail of AI? Like, I saw like there's a Pong and the stuff, so I was like wondering, you said like you have a model for this like sequence reward, but like there's like more complicated rules, like let's say chess.
Yeah, I think
we are not focused on this era, which is more related to game theory, which is we have one expert on game theory and we will probably incorporate some modules for it, but the main aim of our general artificial intelligence is not that we give it rules of chess or Go, and then to make it in a way how the algorithms for chess playing and Go playing are done, which is usually like making big databases and extensive search through all possible movements and stuff like this. We are more interested in the interaction with environment. Maybe in some later future, as a side product, it can be that it can understand playing chess, but it's not our aim.
Martin, I will just add to this that in future, when our AI will be much more advanced, we think it will be actually possible to have it learn play chess or any other game just by interacting with the game board, you know, and from that extracting the rules, and that's it, you know, that's the point. But right now, the game, the AI is able to play Pong. I don't believe it will be able to play chess in each in its current form. But in a few years, after we get these modules in advanced form, or in, they will be able to have some working memory, long-term memory, some better predictions, maybe working with some like symbols. I mean, like people use symbols in language and stuff like that. Then it should be quite easy to play chess. And the idea is that it's a general artificial intelligence, so we kind of don't care where it will be used. You know, it can be used on chess or some other game. It's really not important, because the general AI will be able to learn the rules and just act in a way that's maximizing the reward.
I was wondering, how are you going to handle the evolution of the brain core as the functionality grows, both non-functional properties and functional properties?
Okay, that's a good question. We are not mostly using evolutional algorithms or stuff like this, but the architecture is ready for evolutional algorithms, but we don't use them at the moment because they are quite heavy for resources, because you need to make many parallel executions of the same model and then do the combination and stuff like this. So it's usually not useful for like rapid prototyping, because you need a long time before you get some reasonable result on evolution. So at the moment we do not have there something like auto adaptation or something like reconfiguration of the inner part of the module, but the system is prepared to that we can implement it there, so it's not the part of the system now.
Maybe I would just add to this that usually you want to use evolutional algorithms when you have a system, have a set of parameters, and you want to have them the best set that you can. But right now we are more focused on the architecture part, which is much trickier with the evolution to create a good architecture. Yeah, that's why we are a little postponing this into the phase when we actually will be in need to do this.
And I will add that the way we set the milestone is kind of like copying how the evolution evolved intelligence. Not like 100% copying, but we are basically adding layer after layer of intelligence functionality. But we are doing it in an engineering way. So we don't really, we want to understand why our models work, and we want to, so when we develop some architecture, for example, like for Pong, we actually want to know like okay, this part is doing visual processing, this part is doing predictions on working memory, this part is controlling some muscles or something like that. And we don't want to have just like a set of, like huge set of magic numbers. They are doing what we want, but we don't really know what they are doing. So we really want a modular architecture.
Hello. One thing that I'm wondering about is, I'm not sure whether what you're hoping to do is to have a fixed a network topology and just improve the individual modules to a point where they will be able to solve general problems, or whether you eventually hope to have an algorithm that's going to change the network itself, the structure of the brain itself.
In long term, we want both of them. So we want self-improving of the nodes, but also the improving the topology and rearranging it, probably also making sort of load balancing. So if we find out, or the system finds out, that some part is really heavily used, so it will be enforced, and there will be more resources attached to this part. So we, in long term, really want system which is able to rebuild itself. It's not like that we only make the graph and the graph keeps fixed.
Hello, thank you for the talk. You mentioned pretty wild models. So, like, I mean, everybody expects here that you work with neural network. But you mentioned that you are actually developing your own artificial models. So my question is, when you release your brain simulator, will you include all your models or will you keep something for yourself? And the artificial model you mentioned, what is it based on? Thank you. Well, if it was clear.
Martin, I will answer the first part. So when we will release this platform, we will include all our models and we'll also include probably the demo projects that we created as part of the milestone. So people who will download Brain Simulator, they will do a few clicks and they will launch Pong or maybe some next milestone demo project. And all these projects will contain our AI modules that we developed. And now.
It's hard to say a single model on which it's based. We are using many models. We were testing some spiking networks. We are using feed-forward networks. We are using holographic reduced representation for some internal symbols and stuff like this. So the basic idea is that the task is so complex that you need to use whatever you find. So this is the reason why we are developing the brain simulator. It's like the tool which allows you to use what is the best suitable for your particular task. So the question is not whether we use some single model or some model which solves everything, but we use really hybrid structure for the model.
Yeah, the idea behind Brain Simulator is that it's very heterogeneous. So basically each model focuses on some specific problems where it specializes to solve. Like for example, module on vision is specialized on vision problems and not so much on working memory or prediction or maybe on some goal selection or goal following kind of things. And maybe in nature, human brain is based on spiking neural networks, but the thing is that even they are just implementation of some other algorithms and we want to avoid this long process of finding all these algorithms and their implementation in spiking neural networks. So we are kind of like choosing a faster way and directly implementing each module for what we think the module should be doing.
May I ask? Well, to be honest, there is no such a thing right now. It can be told that it's like an our artificial model. For example, we are really betting on these distributed symbol representations, which suits us very well, and it looks like it is like a natural way how artificial neural networks and maybe even biological neural networks are threaded information. So we believe that the information which is actually stored in a fixed bits or a fixed activity of set of neurons can hold a really big amount of information in parallel. So this is one of the idea we are following right now, and this is the symbolic architecture we are using for symbols in the working memory, for example.
I'd like to ask you a couple of questions. One is you had the example with the Pong game, and well, what it seems to me is that the way how you have made your solution is very overfitting on the game. By that I mean, can you take the code, the design that you have made, and put it into another game and let it run without any any specific large changes of configuration, if you know what I mean?
Yes, this is our next milestone, as Dusan said, that we will use or we will try to find the way how to use it for different games. You are right that the model is overfitting for Pong, but our goal is not to play the Pong in the best way how it can be played, but we are also testing some ideas on this particular sort of simple problem. So we have there experiments on how to represent the space, to test our visual system, to test the working memory and stuff like this. So this is the reason why the model is maybe too complex for playing Pong, but as I said, we don't want to play Pong, so this is like just sort of exercise on which we can simply test our modules as well. So.
Another thing is that a lot of these solutions or artificial intelligence systems are basically designed on human level intelligence. And one thing that humans are really famous for are their stupidity. how do you want to assure that this kind of design, this kind of flaw in the design will not enter the product?
Just a short answer. We'll be very happy to create some AI that will be as stupid as humans.
Thank you.
Here I will maybe say something more about how we actually plan to teach the AI the same things people know. Because if the AI will not have the same knowledge, and I mean like not just some scientific and technical things, but also social behavior, will not be able to speak and communicate with the AI. So we see it that way, that when the AI will be quite advanced, we'll start interacting it and learning it the same values and knowledge that we have. And basically, because the AI will be this universal brain that's just absorbing patterns and understanding all those patterns, it will also understand the patterns of our behavior, our motivations. And if the reward punishment system will be set correctly, it will try to do things that we consider are good. And but there is not 100% like a guarantee for not making mistakes. That's just impossible. It's just like we can reduce the chances to a minimum by tests and so on. But it's same with people, that you cannot know if somebody will do this or that. You still have just some chance, but you cannot know for sure. So it will be similar with AI.
I would like to ask one final question, and that is concerned with ethics. My main concern is that I don't think human level AI intelligence is going to come around really soon, but what I think that is more likely is to design systems that will be able to learn from the data that they can process. And so you are building a system like this, basically, and you will put it as a product publicly available to anyone who can download this and use it. One of my main concern that is really like my nightmare vision of the world almost, is that someone will take this kind of software and use it for analysis of software that is available today, so that they could use it for cybernetics attacks, for example. So how do you deal with ethical issues?
It's a tool. AI is a tool, and any tool can be used for good things and bad things. And for example, computer security is never ending fight between attacks and counter attacks. And basically, this applies also to military and stuff like that, like from the entire history. And so we think that if there will be people who will use AI or machine learning for computer attacks, then there will be also people who will use the same technologies to counterattack. And it will never end, you know, that's what I know for sure. But it's like usually there is more people who have good intentions, and so and they cooperate, and there is more of them, so they have advantage before these people who just want to do some attacks. Of course, it's not 100%. Like nothing in life is 100%, but at least it's something. And ethics in our research, I can say this only for myself, but I think that what anybody would do is that like creator of AI would try to imprint his own view of ethics to the AI child. And so if like good people will create AI, then it will be good. If bad people create AI, then the AI will be bad. But I may be optimist, but I think that the bad people just, they will not create AI because they are focusing not on creation of value, but just like capturing or stealing some other value. So they will not be the people who will be the lucky one who create the AI that can actually be general.
Okay, I would have one question. Is your project in some way related to Mr. Shane Lack and Marcus Hutter definition of artificial general intelligence and their tests of general intelligence?
What was the name?
Shane Lack and Marcus Hutter.
I don't know, I know this name.
No.
I think one of them founded that company DeepMind.
We are aware of DeepMind, but we have no connections to them.
Okay.
From.
Good evening. I have a question. You talk about yourself as a team who develops some general intelligence. Do you know about successes or about another teams in the Czech Republic or in the world? And do you have any connections to them or do you cooperate? Are you planning that? Is it clear?
Yes, it is clear.
Yes. So, of course, we are following the development in other teams, mostly in like international teams or either academia or some companies, like mentioned DeepMind. And we try to learn from their research or from their ideas or the way they are working. And I think we don't cooperate with anyone. But that's going to change because that's one of the reasons why we want to make our project more public. Until now, we're really quiet and mainly for the reason that the project was just starting, so there was no need to talk about it publicly and so. And even now, it's really early stages and we cannot show much more except, you know, like some robot and Pong. But we believe that we are on a good way and we'll start collaborating with these other teams and companies if it will be possible very soon.
And we have also contacts to FIT and to maybe Faculty of Mathematics and Physics, so we will be probably in near future more in touch with local universities and stuff like this. We also were thinking about cooperating on some European projects, but for us it's a little bit complicated because there are more bureaucracy that we want to have.
Yeah. And by the way, this openness is also a reason why we are making this platform to allow other either companies or teams to join us, because the idea is basically that we have some image recognition, some focuser modules, but if somebody has or is able to develop a better modules and just add it to the marketplace, it can help us because it will just be more precise and or faster or anything, and but it will also help other people around. So that's the idea, and basically this is also the idea why we are not focusing that much on like enhancing this image recognition or some other modules, because we know that if we do the ecosystem right, then there will be really really soon somebody who will upload something that's two times better than what we did, and like we save time and it's good.
Okay, thank you. So one more thing. Do you know about anyone else doing the similar thing as you are doing?
Yes, of course. It's probably everybody noticed that in last year it really exploded, you know, the entire interest in AI, machine learning and stuff like that. And we think that even Google, even though it doesn't appear like they are working on general AI, it sometimes looks like they are just making better search or some better audio recognition or stuff like that. But we believe that they are also working on general AI because, I mean, they are smart, so they know what's the potential, so why wouldn't they be not working on AI?
Also, one Canadian team, which is led by Professor Elias Smith, which is designing that Mango system, which was mentioned. We are also aware that they are doing something similar, but they are more focused on biologically plausible models, so they are like more low level than we are. Or it sometimes intersects, but we also know about this work.
Yeah, and also maybe from the higher level, there is a team which is able to run the Super Mario game, and the Mario itself can behave quite wisely in the environment and even can communicate with the outer world and with the researchers on the language basis. So we are aware of them.
Okay, and also we can mention Numenta organization where you have seen this is a company which is doing something in sequence and predictions of sequences. So this is also a company which we are aware of, and we have tested their algorithms as well.
Okay, thank you.
Hello, I have a more philosophical question. When or if the technological singularity happens, when the AI is able to replicate itself and create a more intelligent version of itself, what do you think is the solution so that the human race stays relevant and won't get completely overwhelmed by this exponential growth of intelligence?
Like, we have different views on it in our team, probably. Some of us believe that it will happen, and some of us do not believe in it in like near future. And I think that the solution, if it happens, is that like human will be able to like store their mind in this artificial environment. So it's sort of like extension of body and stuff similar like this. But it's on a level of mind, and the body will not be so important in this sense. Or maybe.
And
yeah.
My view on this is that, I mean, I not believe in singularity. I'm actually trying to create singularity with the team, but that's the crazy part of the answer. But the thing is that whoever creates this advanced AI will not just create AI and then stay there and just die, but he will be probably smart, and so he will probably try to integrate himself with the AI, or maybe upgrade himself with the AI. So actually it will not be like there are people, there are robots, and robots will start growing and growing and growing, and people will stay like this. It's probably that people will also start upgrading themselves and together, because just like we need to look on this from the selfish point of view, and there is no reason to create robots who are a billion times better than we are and then just leave, and we will stay here, you know, like And we'll be asking, like, what we just did, you know, like, what was it for? So, of course, we'll try to be, like, merge with AI.
Thank you.
Hello. I have a question, a bit more of a practical concern. And that's how computationally expensive was playing Pong? I mean, was it okay to play on your laptop, or did you need a server with a couple of high-end GPUs?
Yes, we can play it on laptop, and maybe Dušan can show it.
Maybe. The general effect is dangerous thing.
But here I will point out that currently we don't really focus much more on optimizations. So many of these models are really not optimized, and because we are trying to implement some model, test it, you know, see if it works, if it does things we need it to work, but the optimization phase is really in future. And here it's really useful that we are using CUDA, because CUDA is much more faster than CPU, and so we can live with some ineffectivity.
Yeah, so right now it's playing Pong on the laptop. There's a CUDA card, and it's like 11 frames or the simulation step per second right now. And the most performance demanding thing is the neural network inside, and the network has around 2,000 neurons in the first layer and 1,000 neurons in the output layer.
Yes, and this network is pre-trained, and it took
It's pre-trained.
Like 20,000 steps to train to this level.
20 or 30,000 steps, simulation steps to train it. So there is some time where the network actually grasps the goal states and then tries to learn these states.
And how many minutes was this 20, 30,000 steps?
Well, of course, depends on how the machine
but
is fast.
You said it was like 20 minutes or something like that.
On our desktop computers, it's like about 10 minutes or something.
10 minutes, yeah, of training.
But it's just low-cost card, graphic card, so it would be on some bigger, better. It's in like minutes.
Okay, so I'll have a follow-up question on the ethics guy, who was boring, by the way. I will ask, like, from the other side, in your wildest dreams, like, where do you see your AI? Like, you have shown us the neat six-legged creature. Like, any plans for making fluffy household pets, for example?
No. We want to focus only on the brain part of the AI, and this is why we are opening this platform. And so other companies that maybe want to create some little dogs or self-driving cars or anything like that, they will make their own implementation using our AI brain. And so just imagine that you are a car company, and you know that our AI works, which it doesn't like this at this moment, but in a few years it will. And but so you know that it can do this intelligent thing, and you integrate it in your car, integrate it in the sensor of the car, integrated to the like actuators of the car, I mean like wheel and gas pedal and all these things, and then the AI and also you set some reward and punishment, which can be a little bit complex in this situation, and then the car will learn how to drive or how to actually get the reward. And so our idea is that we really want to focus only on this universal brain and let other institution companies to decide where they will use it.
So more like the Boston Dynamics soldier with the reward and punish instinct?
If they will decide to use it in their robot, then they can.
Okay, thanks. Maybe one more question, short one. Like you mentioned the car driving itself. Isn't it like the more rigid algorithms more suitable for these cars than like thinking AI?
There might be, but this is also the question of the like this threshold that I was mentioning, that maybe you can solve a self-driving car by machine learning and really statistical approaches and solutions, or maybe not, you know, like you really need to test it, because if you see the results that Google self-driving car has right now, there are still some and many situations that the car cannot handle. You know, like for example, if there are holes in the road, the car will just drive through the holes. Or if there is, I think, like bad weather, the car will not be able to drive correctly and so on. So it has its limits. And of course, our approach will have its limits, but if as we will go more and more universal and able to process much more complex patterns of like situation, then it should have advantage over like simpler models that don't. It's basically like this, that if you compare yourself with a dog, for example, the dog sees the same world as you see, but because he has also eyes and he's in the same environment, everything, but the dog doesn't see the patterns in the world that you see. The dog doesn't see that this is car and the car has this price and is this brand and all these things. The dog doesn't see it, even though it's in there. And it's only because the dog doesn't have the system to recognize all these patterns in some hierarchies and so on. And so what we think is that if our AI will be universal and advanced enough, it will be able to find all these patterns and then act, you know, in best interest of who sets the reward.
Thanks.
What is your strategy, or I guess your vision, for maintaining intellectual property in terms of, let's say, keeping ownership of certain AI patterns, as opposed to, let's say, something that somebody else might develop and copyright it for themselves because the process is different?
Well, obviously we cannot do like copyright thefts or patent infringements, so we'll need to be careful in this. And as I know, what we developed is ours, and what we are using like third-party things, it usually copyleft, or you know, like there is license that allows it. And if then, like maybe the other side, how you can look on this is that if somebody will try to steal our AI modules, algorithms, ideas, then I guess maybe there is not much we can do about this, but it's similar how we treat this with our games, because we know that there are people who are pirating our games, but we don't care, you know. So it's like we really don't want to force anybody to do, like if they don't want to pay, then just don't pay, and that's it.
Right. Well, I mean, the reason why I ask is one of the ways you said that you would commercialize your AI would be through licensing. But if all you can have is, let's say, an underlining software where you would have other companies, let's say, create the processes for those particular applications, if that's your only plan, let's say, revenue stream is official licenses for, let's say, sanctioned applications. I mean, is that kind of the way forward you see in terms of this being a profitable business?
Yeah. So we think that the best modules on this market will be ours, or the most important will be ours. And if not, if there will be still some better third-party modules, then we will license them. So the idea is that somebody or some company will give a module to our platform, and this module will get used in some car or anything. The company who created the module will get some share of the revenue that we receive. That's the idea. We don't know. Right now, we don't know how to like split it, you know, or like how to deal with, like, if there are, for example, five different companies working on or having their AI modules in one brain or one end product, how to deal with royalties in this situation. But we'll solve this in future.
Okay, I have some technical remark. We are maybe out of time, so I would suggest to make 5-minute breaks for those who want to leave, and then we can continue in discussion if it's okay. Or we should end.
I think we should end in 10 minutes.
Okay, so we have last 10 minutes, so without break.
Good evening. I would like to ask a question, how much is actually the algorithm hard-coded for a particular task it is performing? To illustrate my point, for example, if I would take your current algorithm without modifications and I would rotate the game 90 degrees, would it be still able to play that?
Well, with no problem. This is really no problem, and it's not tested because we just started with
the whole experimenting thing, not really back in the future, in the past, but I still believe that the same, exactly same model will be able to play games like River Ride, for example, or maybe even Space Invaders.
Would it need additional time for learning? Or would it be able to use the same learned patterns for the game which is just rotated?
Well, you mean if the game is rotated, if there will be additional learning? Yeah, I was talking about the model, not the instance of the model. Of course, the model have to find that something gets changed. So additional learning will be needed.
Yeah, you know, my point is that if you would present this task to human, mm-hmm. he would be able to use the same knowledge.
That's correct, but the human has a concept of getting an idea or having an idea that something is rotated in different way than it was before, and I'm pretty sure that this model don't have it just because it wasn't learned for that. Mm. You were learned that these things are actually the same things, only rotated, which is quite high-level knowledge.
I see. All right.
It's also related to some like internal representation of that world, which is built there somehow. It's learned, and at the moment it's not flexible enough to use the same internal representation for the game, but we are trying to do it as general that it would be possible in future in this way, that you just rotate it and the system understands that you rotate it.
All right, thank you for your answer. One more thing, it's an ethical question. Let's say we will succeed in this task, and at some point we will have the intelligence which is equal to human or even better than human. And we as humans, we rule the other creatures because we are more intelligent. And my question is, whether do you think it's a good strategy from evolution point of view to develop something which is more intelligent than you?
Actually, I think it's the best strategy because you cannot be sure that there is not somebody else working on it, maybe with bad intentions, or maybe there are not some AI aliens just flying to our planet. And so I think it's the best strategy, and it's actually a better shot at our future, because if we don't do AI, or if we don't advance in technology, then almost everybody who sits in this room will be dead in 50 or 100 years, because we will just be old, you know. And with AI, we have, at least we have a chance, little chance, but we have a chance to basically live forever. And so just from pure like, strategy point of view, I think it's good strategy. We just need to be, or the creators of AI need to be careful to not get killed by AI, you know, when it actually happens.
One last question, because I know we are running out of time. So do you think it's possible in principle to control something which is much more intelligent than you? I'm saying like not somebody's 130 IQ, somebody else is 160, but we are talking about, let's say, 1 million IQ. Do you think in principle it's possible to control such a thing?
I don't think it's possible, but as we said before, we are like aiming in a way that it will extend our capability, so we will be sort of part of it. It's not the case that it will be completely disconnected from our way of thinking or something like this.
Thank you.
Thanks. Critical part of the artificial intelligence is machine learning. So learning itself, it involves a lot of optimization. I haven't seen many optimization approaches around your architecture. Do you plan to investigate it or focus more on experimenting or inventing new ways how to optimize, for example, parameters of neural networks, or we are just planning to use some existing algorithms and focus on architecture?
Well, I'm not really sure if we are strong enough right now to develop something which will be way better in optimization task than optimizers which is already there. So right now I think we are not really planning to develop some better optimization algorithms. Yeah, but it may change if we find that it is not usable, or there's nothing usable for us. But I think this isn't really probable in the near future.
I am curious whether do you have some master plan how to develop your system? I mean, you presented here there is some system that is able to play Pong. The next level is going to be game again, I mean Tetris. Then there will be Need for Speed and then Counter-Strike. Yeah? So this is like a game-based development. But in India, one question is whether the system at the end will be able to play Counter-Strike as good as the Pong at the beginning. Together, I mean all the games together, but this is not my question. I mean, would you like to stick to the like engineer point of view? That mean that the architecture of a system is like task based, or you will stick to a, let's say, bio inspired or like a human based principle? I mean, you will create the models that are in a human brain. That means mimic the human brain and create some complex and sophisticated architecture at the beginning, and then test it on a task.
I think we are doing both of them. We are trying to inspire from biology as well from engineering. So we are doing like mixture of this. The game exercise, I would say, call it, is because it's like simple to test. It's not our aim to play all the games which are there, but we are all more, as I said, even with the Pong, we are trying to test, for example, working memory and pattern recognition and stuff like this, which are much more sophisticated that is needed for playing artificial games, and we are inspired from biological systems in solving these tasks. Maybe it's time for the last question.
So, my question is, the AI is pretty good at, or technology generally is pretty good at replacing jobs. What do you think is the solution when, like, 30%, or I don't know how many percent, but a lot of people are employed in transportation and selling items. So what should we do when these jobs simply disappear to the AI and a large section of the population becomes unemployed because these jobs will simply disappear?
Well, I think as right now we are seeing that the jobs are disappearing because of the AI is evolving pretty fast. I think in the same way there will be new job opportunities for human. Maybe it will require different skills, but still I think it is really, or we are not capable to really see what will happen. And I personally don't believe that people will don't have enough work to do in the future.
Okay, so last plus one question.
Good evening, thank you for the talk. May I ask you what's the average salary of an AI programmer in your company?
That's better to discuss in private.
Okay, I understand, thank you very much.
Okay, so thank you very much for your time. Thank you.